Good evening. I was asked to speak today about ways to succeed in our Torah learning. The world in this generation is full of seminars and plenty of books, how to succeed in everything you ever heard of. Financially, marriage, rehabs, addictions, all kinds of things. Some of them more correct than others, some of them totally nonsense. Some of them actually cause the other way around, to make us fail more, especially the marriage counselor in a secular world. They make the marriage end faster with their advices, because their advices is the opposite of Hashem. They give advices to do certain averos that only makes the marriage worse eventually. Maybe it looks that it helps for a week or two, but after that it creates huge problems. When we come to get an advice about everything of our life, we already know where the address is. We come to the Torah and we see what the Torah says. Everybody knows from day one that he goes to pre-1A, Limud Torah keneged kulam. You heard it a million times in your life. Torah, 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 ki em chayenu v'orech yamenu. Most of us even respect the Talmidei Chachamim. Some of us are jealous with them, which is a very good positive jealousy. The only permitted jealousy is to be jealous with Talmidei Chachamim. But no matter how much we're jealous with these Talmidei Chachamim, it seems that we are not following their path, some of us. Without generalizing, but we also find that many of the people that learn for X amount of years and achieve a nice level, they eventually get depressed. They don't want to hear anymore from Torah. They don't want to get up. It's very difficult for them to open the book after a while. It happens to teenagers. It happens to adults. And usually, when a person leaves the Torah, there's two tragedies here. One is that you miss the mitzvah of Talmud Torah keneged kulam. And we all know the cheshbon of the Chafetz Chaim. The person can do 1,000 mitzvot in average per minute by learning Torah. 200 words, 5 letters average. Each letter is mitzvah aseh d'oraita. 1,000 mitzvot in a minute, 60,000 mitzvot per hour, 600,000 mitzvot per average man of an avrech koilel. Wonderful. A regular Baal Tshuva or from birth businessman, Baal Bais, doesn't do it in his entire life. What an avrech does in one day in koilel, will learn 10 hours serious, be'amal, right there. Because how many mitzvot we do in a day? Get up in the morning, you go daven shachris, mitzvah de rabbanan, birkot ha-shachas de rabbanan. What do? You put talits, one de oraita, two tefillin, three, birkat amazon, another one, four, put some tzedakah, five. You add, count, 1, 2, 3, 10, 20, you don't get to 30 a day. So without the Torah, the profit is very small. Even though we're not allowed to compare between one mitzvah to the other, as we all know, Hashem didn't tell the reward of the mitzvot. Didn't want people to not appreciate enough each mitzvah and mitzvah. But we do know that limud Torah keneged kulam, meaning all the others compare the Torah, is very, very far on the list. So when a person leaves the Torah, the first tragedy is that he loses this huge reward and the kedusha of the Torah. The problem is that sometimes it ends with a double tragedy, that it goes so low eventually that I don't even want to say where it ends. We all see cases like this. I see it all the time. I mean, there's not one day that I don't get at least one or two cases like this. especially if they go to universities, replacing the Torah with the nonsense they teach over there, that's already a death sentence. Spiritually, I'm talking. Maybe they'll become important people and they make good money and they establish financially. Yes, I know that. I see what's going on out there. But many of us, because of that, we become apikorsim. We learn chokhmot chitzoniot. We think it doesn't contradict the Torah. It's, you know, we have the Torah, we respect the Torah, it's the divine knowledge, but there is also other things. As long as it doesn't contradict the Torah, no problem, we need parnasa. But the atmosphere in the university, if you only knew how many bachurei yeshiva, as soon as they got there, how quick they went off the derech, you'll be shocked with the statistic. Yes, I know you're going to point, but look at this guy. He stayed a learner, he's still kovei ha'itim. And he became a doctor, and he became a lawyer, and he became an accountant, yes. But the question is that risk, the risk when you put a kid over there, maybe he'll be a rich man, maybe he will support his family nicely without begging for donations. Is that risk justified? Is it pay to take such a risk? Because obviously nobody dreamed that when he puts his learner, tzaddik, out of yeshiva and he put him into university, where he's going to end. And when he ended in the worst place possible, then if you tell him, how much would you pay to go back to the day before he went there? How much are you willing to pay? So I will sell my home and give it out just to get him back to the day before I sent him over there. So it's like a Russian roulette. We turn the wheel. Let's see if we get lucky. If we got lucky, stay frum. Maybe one day he's going to go back to learning a lot when he has some money. Most of the time, it doesn't end like that. The question is, how does a person stay all his life connected to the Torah, no matter what happened around in his life? So we all know the important Rambam in Ilchot Talmud Torah, Kol Ish Mi Yisrael Chayav B'Talmud Torah. I'm sure you heard it at least 100 times minimum, but let's just get a little bit deeper than usual. Kol Ish Mi Yisrael Chayav B'Talmud Torah. Every Jew has an obligation to learn Torah, Ben Ani, Ben Ashir, whether he's rich, whether he's poor, Ben Shalem Begufo, Ben Baal Isurim, whether he's healthy, whether he has his handicap, or he has all kinds of sicknesses. Ben Bachur, whether he's young. Ben Shiye Zaken, whether he's very old. Shetashash Kocho, barely walks. Afilu haya ani amitparnes min atzdaka umichazer al haptachim. Someone who's collecting for his, you know, survival. אפילו בעל אישה ובנים חייב לקבוע לו זמן לתלמוד תורה. Even he has family and many children, he has to worry about them, he has no time to breathe. Must set up daily time to learn Torah in the morning, in a day, and in the night. שנאמר, והגית בו יומם ולילה. עד מתי חייב ללמוד תורה? Until when this obligation remain? עד יום מותו. It's 101 years old. He cannot move. One step, 10 minutes. Another step, 10 minutes. Going to collect. I've seen one old man like this in Brooklyn, maybe 90 years old, still collecting. I don't know how he has the strength. He can barely move, but collects. Comes, he collects. He goes all the way down like this. He collects. Someone like that, according to the Rambam, has an obligation to learn day and night. No discounts. וכל זמן שלא יעסוק בתורה הוא שוכח. The Torah is like a muscle. Muscle meaning if you work on your muscle, let's say you have very weak muscles, you cannot lift anything. So you know, you never trained yourself. You begin to work on your muscles. After a month, if you were able to lift 10 pounds, now you can lift 15 pounds. And 20 and 30 and eventually 300, easy. But in the day one, 300, you can't even move. But something about the muscle, when you train it, it becomes stronger and stronger. But what happens if you stop one day? Everything goes back to be watery. just worse than day one. Eventually, after a few months, ממש danger for them. That's why they must, once you start with working out, you're basically in it for the rest of your life. You cannot ever let it go, because then it becomes worse than what it was eventually. It's like, that's it. Contract for life. Torah, it's similar in one point. What's the similarity? That you may think you learn X amount of things, you stop, that's it. Is this, you have this knowledge forever. The answer is no. After a while, you stop to learn, you begin to forget until you get back to almost zero. And I have people sometimes in my lectures, they were in yeshiva from day one, since they're little kids, until 20, 21. They learned about 16 years Torah, and they total, total amei haratzot. They don't know one Mishnah. They don't know one thing from the Chumash to say, nothing. 16 years, Aita beYeshiva, you're in yeshiva 16 years, what's going on here? Ma, everything is gone within 5 years? Of course, if he comes back to yeshiva, maybe he will come back to him, yes. But as it is now, in his tuma, nothing. And even when he tried to say something, usually it's the opposite of what it means. He say the opposite. The Baal HaTanya is talking about this. This is what he says. לא אמרו קביעות עתים לתורה, אלא במי שצריך לעסוק בדרך ארץ להחיות נפשו ונפשות ביתו. What we say that is an obligation for every Jew to set up time every day to learn Torah, it's for whom? For Baalei Batim, for people that work, they have business, they work somewhere, they work for someone, and they have to take care of their family. So for them, they set times. אבל מי שאין צריך לכך, או מתפרנס משל אחרים, someone that somebody supports him, let's say his father or his brother, or someone gives him money, he has parnasa. חייב לקיים והגית בו יומם ולילה כמשמעו. Somebody like that, his obligation become every minute of his life. Doesn't have one minute that he doesn't have the obligation. Then it gets better. One day, the Midrash Shocher Tov is bringing on Mishlei. It says like this: Bo ure kama kashe yom adin. Come and see how horrible is yom adin, the judgment day. She'atid HaKadosh Baruch Hu ladun et kol ha'olam kulo be'emek Yehoshafat. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu will judge the entire world in a place called Emek Yehoshafat. Yehoshafat Valley. Don't ask me where it is, but we at least, as long as we understand that this day will happen one day. וכיוון שתלמיד חכם בא לפניו, when someone that's considered a תלמיד חכם comes in front of him, אומר לו, כלום עסקת בתורה? Did you learn Torah? Your Torah was your business? אמר הן, say yes. אמר לו הקדוש ברוך הוא, השם אנסר, הועיל ועודת, אמור לפני מה שקרית. Since you're honest, you admit it, that you learned Torah, it was your business, your main thing in your life. Let's see what you learn. ומה ששנית, מכאן אמרו, from here we learn, כל מה שקרה אדם, everything that a person learned, יהיה תפוס בידו. ומה ששנה, תהיה תפוס בידו. שלא תשיגהו בושה או כלימה ליום הדין. You finally learn something, you must learn it good. Not like they say in Israel, חפיף. Ah, it's a hard Rashi. No, come on, I can't have it. It's 20 minutes we're on this Rashi. Let's move on. No, later we'll ask someone. Later, when is later? When Mashiach come, maybe that later would be. An hour later, he doesn't even remember he skipped few Rashi in this learning. Why? What makes him run, what we call today, pkius, quickly, more pages. Why is it? Because people say, when will I ever finish such a long Torah? If I'm going to be learning with Iyun and every sugiya so much, I'll get depressed. After 10 years in yeshiva, I'll finish one perek in a shas. When people finish half of the shas or maybe the whole shas, how will I talk around my friend? They ask me, what did you learn? I say, I learned 80 pages of Gemara in my whole life. 10 years, that's it. We do it in a month. That's the big trap here. But first of all, we know the Chazal, lo alecha melacha ligmor. There's no obligation to finish the Torah. No obligation. Nobody gets paid based on how many pages he finished in his life, in case you were wondering. Only on how much time and efforts you dedicated for the Torah. Even if you learn all your life, one perek, and until you finally, with your ability in your brain, finally understood it correctly, that's considered exactly like someone who finished the Shas 10 times. It's no difference. Why? Because the sachar b'shamayim goes on the efforts. That's the main sachar. Achievement in this world, it's very important. If you take your car to the mechanic, and he works on that 1 week, and he couldn't find a problem. Electrical short somewhere in a system. Try to change this sensor, it's not it. Change this, it's not it. The wire here looks cut. Let's change the whole wire. It's not it. He changed half of the car already. Already thousands of dollars invested in the car, this mechanic. Poor mechanic, he cursed the day he was born. After a week of working from morning to night, his wife calling, Moshe, where are you? Don't wait for me, I'm stuck here. 10 o'clock, what's going on with you? The customer's gonna sue me. I can't, it's already 4 days, I don't fix the problem. It's gonna ruin my reputation. I have to stay overnight. After a week of a nightmare, he didn't fix the problem. The customer is fuming, he comes on Friday, no? So I'm very sorry. I couldn't find the problem. So, okay, give me the key, you'll hear from my lawyer. He said, wait a minute, you cannot have the key. It's $3,800, the bill. What? You want money for wasting a week of my life without a car, I'm stuck, no? You still want to get paid? So what about me? I don't have a wife, I don't have children. I work weeks, every night here I stayed. Who knows, I work maybe 70 hours of your car. 70 hours, $60 an hour, $4,200 the bill. I gave you 10% discount, only $3,800. Do you think anybody would pay such a guy? Not only nobody would pay him, everyone would take him to Beit Din for his chutzpah that he calls himself a mechanic or a professional. But Baruch Hashem, Hashem is not like that. That mechanic, according to Hashem, gets fully paid. Not in mechanic. When a person learned Torah all week, tried to understand, he couldn't understand. He gets paid like he understood. His friend did, and he didn't. He gets paid for his effort. He put all full effort. It's not his fault his brain is not so sharp. Everybody knows the famous story with Rav Moshe Feinstein, Zatzal, about that boxer that sent his kid to yeshiva and the kid made him frum, comes with tzitzit. His father was a complete Am Haaretz. And after a while, he called Rav Moshe Feinstein. He say, Rabbi, I'm doing a siyum today. Would you come in the evening right here in Lower East Side? So he asked him, what do you mesayim? What's the siyum for? He told him, I finished one page in the Gemara. Now, you know, Rav Moshe Feinstein knew no one would call to make a joke with me now. So he asked him, you know, how long you've been learning? He found out that he was learning it for a long, long time. He understood the case. And he said to him, no problem, tell me where, I'll be there. When the neighborhood heard that Moshe Feinstein go to that siyum, so more people came. And then he said in that siyum, sometimes a person is sent to the world for 70, 80 years to live here, to run around, all for one page of Gemara to complete what he didn't finish in his previous life. Now he completed that page. It could be he cut to 100% of what he was supposed to. And then that night, this man passed away. He went home, went to sleep, and never woke up. Mamash nevuah came out of his mouth. When after he made that siyum, he went home, he went to sleep and didn't get up. It could be coincidence, such a thing. 70, 80 years to run in the world, business, traffic, people, aggravation, wife, children, running around, everything was for that page. Apparently, yes. Nistarot darkei Hashem. So, everybody gets tested. Now imagine we learn so much, learn for years, while we don't know one sugiyah 100%. What a tremendous embarrassment is going to be. Person is avrech in kollel 20 years. Hashem say to him, okay, let's hear what you know. What do you want to start with? Say, let's say, amafkid etzel chavero. Let's talk about amafkid. No, tell me about amafkid. right away, he's asking him a few questions, but why the Gemara say this, why this, why Tosfot ask here, and over there he asks like that. He begins to stutter. The embarrassment begins, but it's not going to end. Because now you have to report for 20, 30, 40 years, Habibi. It's not like here, your father come and ask the kid, no, let's see how you understand this Gemara. Abba, I'm tired, no, please, tomorrow I'll do. Okay, surrender, the father. It's not such a test over there. That's 100%. And a person gonna stand over there and doesn't know anything. And then the excuses will begin. But the problem is, excuses only work here. Over there, it's Olam HaEmet, no excuses. The excuses only gonna make the situation worse. We saw what happened to Shaul when Shmuel came to him and asked him, what's this, the noise of the sheep here? Instead of saying, Chatati, you're right, I didn't fulfill Hashem's order 100%, started to make excuses. The nation, they wanted to make sacrifices to Hashem. But with David, right away, he made tshuva, Chatati, it's my mistake. Even here, Hashem doesn't like excuses. Over there, what are we going to say? So one way we can ask Hashem, I'm sorry, Hashem, is that my fault that my memory is so messed up? I don't have a memory, ma. It's your fault. I see some people learn right away. They learn the page. After an hour, they can tell you the whole page by heart. I learned it 50 times. A month later, I don't remember anything. 50 times I learned it, not 4 times. What do you want from me? What do you think? This excuse is good or no? Maybe it's a legit excuse. We can't deny the fact that some kids have more memory than others. I had one secular guy in one of my lectures, maybe 15 years ago, Kuczynski, his last name. Complete Chiloni, Israeli. And I was arguing with him, trying to make him Baal Tshuva. And as we argue, I saw that he knows a lot. For a secular person, he knew a lot. He was learning on his free time. He argued with me about Malchut Bet David. What does it mean, this pasuk, that pasuk? What does it mean, where is David today? How come it say Le'olam, and David is not alive? I was asking good questions. That was before I had computer that you can pull everything on the spot, in the primitive days. So I asked the people that own the place if they have Tanakh. They didn't have Tanakh. We live in a generation that some Jews don't have Tanakh in their homes. They didn't have Tanakh, so he told me, I live one block away, I have Tanakh at my home. I said, it was already 5 a.m. We are arguing all night, and there's a large audience listening to this debate all night. And then he said, I have in my home. I said, okay, let's go to your home, 5 a.m. We went to his home, we argue until 6. But while I was arguing before we left, I saw that I'm talking to him, and he's writing things in his notebook. Or thinking to myself, this guy is professional. He argues, he makes comments. Then later I got up, I got tired of sitting, so I got closer to him, I see he's playing games. You know, X, zero. I said to him, is this Derech Eretz? Someone argue with you in the Devarei Torah and you're playing games? So he said to me, why? I didn't answer you to the point. I say, yeah, you answer to the point, but still it's not Derech Eretz. He said, ah, don't mind me. I always do a few things at the same time. I felt there's something here. So I asked him, what do you mean? He said, you can tell me now 30 digits in a row, and I can look, you can write them on a piece of paper, and I look at the paper for 30 seconds, and I tell you all the digits from right to left, and then from left to right. Right away, I thought maybe this is a trick here. So I told him, what happened if it will be 33 digits? It's even 100. I just need a little bit longer to look. So I said to the girl over there, please write on a note. You know, she took these yellow stickers. She started to write numbers. I looked at that, not even 15 seconds. Like this, say, okay. I say, okay, so from left to right or from right to left? So from the end to the beginning, in reverse. Told me all the numbers. Later, when we went to his home, we continued the arguments. I gave him a book. That was before we had thousands of CDs in a trunk. First aid. I gave him a book, Mesilot El HaEmunah, Paths to the Faith, in Hebrew. I gave him the book. I said, read this book, make comments. You have more questions, call me. We'll continue from there. So I say to him, write down my telephone number. He said, no, tell me the number, it's okay. I give him the number, he's not writing it down. I said to him, next week, until next week, you're not gonna know the number. Say to me, all the telephone numbers that people told me in my life, I can tell it to you now, since I'm a kid, until now, all of them by heart. I started to shake. I said to him, seriously? He said, yes. Tov, I went away. I came back to the neighborhood. That was Tuesday morning already. I came there Wednesday night, 8 full days later. Wednesday night, I go to the bakery, I see his roommate. Where is Giora Kuczynski? He tells me he's at home. I say, well, what's with him? He say, did he read the book? He say, yeah, no, he's trying to get a job now. He's Wall Street, whatever. I said, you can come talk to him, he's in the house. I say, okay, let's go. One block away, I went there, he comes out with the letters in his hand. I said to him, did you read the book? He said, oh, not you again. I said to him, did you read the book? He said, no, I didn't have time. But I can tell you the numbers 8 days later. Now, I don't have to tell you that all week I was with this note in my pocket showing everyone, can you believe this guy looks at that 15 cents? He knows all. I pull up the notes, no, told me all the numbers, 8 days later, 30 digits. I say, we have a potential of a Nur Avchaim Kanievsky here. All we have to do, make him a Baal Tshuva. Everything we'll ever learn, he never forgets. Think about it, what a gift. Believe it or not, I already know 3 people like this, young, in their 20s. One already arrived to 30, the other one is 20, and one is 23. Everything they ever learn, they remember word by word. Every page, every line. 3 people like this in the world already. It's a gift from Shamayim. But I didn't come here to talk about the talented that got a special gift from Hashem. Hashem has his reasons why these people have phenomenal memory. We talk about the ordinary people. The ordinary people that Chazal spoke about, they're not exactly computer heads. Let's see some advice how we can improve our learning. First, it says like this. Chazal say in Masechet Sanhedrin, page Tzadik Tet, Kidvar Hashem Baza. Someone who disgracing the name of Hashem. Do you know any Jew in the world that is willing to do such thing? You give a Jew on a cloth of mezuzah, Yud Kei Vav Kei. Tell him, put it on the floor and step on it. So you're crazy? Say, what do you care? You're not religious. You make fun at religious. Do it. Say, no, no. I have my red lines. I am not going to do it. Say, okay, spit at it. He won't agree. Almost no one would agree. Take 1 million Jews, secular, ask them one by one. How many would agree? I doubt that if you can have 5. They won't agree to be mevaze Shem Hashem. Why they're not keeping mitzvot? They don't believe. They blame Chazal. They think they made it up. They don't believe in Torah Shebe'al Peh. They don't know what the Torah is. There's a lot of excuses. But to actually be on purpose mevaze Hashem, it's very, very, very rare. So what's going on over here? Chazal say, Kidvar Hashem Baza ve'onsho karet. Chazal say karet. It's not one of the 36 karets in the Torah. But that's what Chazal say. Ze she'efshar lo la'asok ba'Torah ve'eno osek. Someone that has time to learn Torah and is doing other things. Sports, basketball, library, computer works, you know, watching, all kinds of things. Music. He has a lot of hobbies. Assuming it's kosher. We're not talking averos here. We're talking, he does kosher things, but not learning Torah. Rav Chaim Mivolozhin once gave a drasha on Shabbos, and he said this Gemara in Sanhedrin, and he said each one of us has to look at himself that he falls into this category, Kidvar Hashem Baza, and Chas V'Shalom is no share to the world to come. The voice of the crying of the people in the crowd was so loud, he couldn't finish his drasha. In the middle of the drasha, he went and sent down. From how much the people were crying. We heard it 50 times, 100 times, 500 times. Not one drop coming out. Chazon Ish writes in one place, I believe it's in Emunah Bitachon, me if the person will have the merit one time in his life to feel how horrible his situation here by not learning Torah, not knowing Torah, and will cry from that, he should already know that he already achieved a lot. If we get one time in our life to a situation that you sit in your couch at home, no one is around, and you begin, your tears falling, starting to fall on your vest, and your vest becoming wet, falling and falling and falling, and what are you crying about? Not that you lost money in the market today. Not for that, a lot of people cry. For other things, they cry. You're crying that you learn all your life, whatever you learn, and you didn't achieve anything. I remember when I was in yeshiva, that we had one bachur that came from South America. He became Baal Tshuva. He was the champion of South America in math. From all the countries, he won number one in math. I don't have to tell you what a brain he had. In 2 years that he was in yeshiva, there was not one thing in the Talmud he wasn't perfectly aware of, knowing pages, Tosfot, all the opinions, computer head like this. People that were in yeshiva 7 years back then, and he's there only a year maybe, everybody comes to ask him where everything is in the Gemara. It goes like this, he tells you exactly where it is. Mamash the computer sitting in a room. One time the Rosh Yeshiva, he couldn't give the shiur. I know he had a problem with his throat. He was giving daily shiur. Prepare a few gmarot, cross between them. He couldn't give the shiur. He didn't know what to do. So he asked him if he can give the shiur. So he got 7 or 8 gmarot. So he puts one on top of the other. And he started to give a shiur. By the time he finished the 45-minute shiur, the Rosh Yeshiva got on a stand like this and started to have tears. I saw tears falling from his face. I learned 45 years I learned. And I will never be able to give such a shiur. That's how he was crying. Like this is mamash, the words of the Chazon Ish itkaymu bo. I saw his face red like a tomato. Took out his glasses and was wiping his tears. He said, I learned 45 years. This is one year Baal Tshuva. Of course, it's not an ordinary one. It's one in a million. Yeah? But the Chazon Ish say, if a person cry because he wants to know and he doesn't know, that's already a huge achievement in the eyes of Hashem. We have one thing to clarify between the Bavli and the Yerushalmi. Maybe you can help me out. It says, in one place, in the Yerushalmi, in the end of Masechet Brachot, it says, Kol ha'ose torato itim, hare ze mefer brit. Someone that set daily time to learn Torah is actually breaking the covenant with Hashem. Shekatuv, et la'asot la'Hashem, aferu toratecha. They actually break the covenant. Klomar, we learn from here, lo dai lo la'adam itim. It's not enough to set up daily time. If you set daily time, it's actually breaking the agreement with Hashem. That's the Yerushalmi. Ela chayav lilmod tamid kipshuto. All the time. There's not 1 minute that it stops. All the time you have an obligation to learn. But in the Bavli, in Masechet Shabbat, page Lamed Aleph, it says it's enough that you set up daily time. And that's the question in Bedin Shel Mala. When a person died, they ask him, Kavata itim la Torah. They even ask Gdolei Ador that question. Kavata itim la Torah? Even though all his life was learning, they still ask him, Kavata itim. So which one is right? The Bavli, the Yerushalmi, do we have a contradiction between them? Are they talking about two different scenarios? What's going on here? In Yerushalmi, there's no such thing kviat itim la Torah. You must learn Torah every second of your life. That's it. Of course, if you're anus, in a bathroom, you're sleeping, it's a different story. But when you can learn, you have an obligation. You may come and say, oh, my daughter gets married tonight. One melamed in Bnei Brak was learning with a group of Bale Batim from 8 to 9, every night in Bnei Brak. One day he said to them, you know, my daughter get married tomorrow. So tomorrow I won't come, but I want you to go over the Chomer, learn in Chevruto tomorrow. I won't come to give the shiur. And so, of course. He said, but I don't want you to come to the chupa. Finish the shiur, and 9 o'clock you come. It was maybe 2 blocks away in Bnei Brak, the hall. The next day, they already said to learn Chevruto. He showed up with his suit. What happened? He said, I just realized the rabbi just arrived. Until they see it on the ketubah, until the pictures, this, that, I can make it until 9. And he gave the shiur, and 9 o'clock together, they all went. That's called Ahava LaTorah. You have all the excuses in the world. If you wouldn't go, Hashem understand, as your daughter get married, come on, don't be fanatic. But his heart didn't let him miss the shiur. He ran right back, and he did the shiur. The Shla explains the contradiction, Lichora. It says like this. He's talking about two different scenarios. Of course, the person has an obligation to learn in any open minute of his life. Chayav lasok b'Torah. Ve'atidim lekatreg alav she'istamech al itim. In Bet Din Shel Mala, the category will have a case against him that he was only setting time every day to learn. 1 hour, 2 hours, 5 hours, whatever the time was. But besides that a person must set itim laTorah, still has an obligation to learn in every open minute that opened up for him. He was supposed to have a meeting, they cancel, now he has 2 hours at work, right away he takes out his Gemara, whatever he learns, right away the obligation returns. So in other words, yes, you have other things in life. You have morning and evening that you're not moving away from it, no matter what happened, even if they're offering you a great meeting. You say, this time I don't exist. From morning, from 8 to 10, my phone is off, the world is off. You can't reach me, consider me dead, chas v'shalom. Don't try even to reach me. And at night, same thing. When I come from work, I have my chevruta, morning, evening, finished. Besides that, there's the obligation of the Yerushalmi. Every open minute you have, day off, Columbus Day, Santa Claus Day, whatever the day is. In America, there's a lot of reasons for days off. What do you do in these days? Your office is closed. I go on a picnic. Fine, you want to go on a picnic? Go on a picnic. What can I tell you? Well, the obligation is every minute. Now it says like this, אין לך בן חורין, אלא מי שעוסק בתורה. לא קיבלו ישראל את התורה, אלא כדי שלא תהיה אומה ולשון שולטת בהם. No one is free like someone that learns Torah. The nation of Israel received the Torah that no other nation will control them. אלא כדי שלא יהיה מלאך המוות שולט בהם. So the Gemara, it says like this. Why the nation of Israel received the Torah? Few reasons. One, to be Bnei Chorin. Second, that no one will control them, not Malach HaMavet, not the Umot, etc. I want to ask you a question. Someone that learns Torah, what exactly is considered Uben Chorin? Someone that has $1 billion cash is not Ben Chorin. He's retired. He drives his Bentley. He goes to play golf. Nobody tells him what to do. And this Avrech, if he comes 5 minutes late to yeshiva, they tell him, go find yourself another kollel. Where exactly is Ben Chorin here? Besides the poverty, besides the stress, besides the family, and sometimes his wife is also his boss. So the question is, where is the Ben Chorin here? Just to make up sismaot like this, Ben lecha Ben Chorin. What do they mean by saying that? Ben Chorin means freedom. Someone who came from slavery to freedom, from jail to freedom. That's called Ben Chorin. Someone that sits and learns Torah, it's full obligation. It's much harder than any other job. You all know it. Much more stressful and headache and try to understand and break your head and... It takes away all your energy. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul Zatzal say, I don't understand how can it be that there is Seder Shlishi in Yeshivot. How can it be? Why? Because by him, 7 p.m., when he finished the learning of the day, he couldn't get up from the chair. I had to help him to get up, because he was learning in such level, he took away all his energy. Kolam kabel al atzmo, you know the story with Rish Lakish. As soon as he arrived to Rabbi Yochanan, as soon as he accepted to come to the yeshiva, before he even opened a book, he already lost all his energy, ledvar avera. Rak mekabel, kvar the Satan is making him weak. So, what does it mean, Ben Chorin? I'll tell you what it means. Not physically. Physically, en shum Ben Chorin. It's talking mentally. What does it mean? Most of the people today, look in America what's going on. If you deal with the public, you know what I'm talking about. Most of the people are sad. They're not happy. They're not alive. They're all thinking and depressed and sad and have stress. And many take Prozac and anxiety attack and panic attack and fear from that and worry about that. Every other person you meet, doesn't matter, rich, poor, everyone, like they say in Israel, panim tisha be'av. Face of tisha be'av. Most of the time. Don't look at some Hasidim who dance after they have some lechaim and have a siyum masechet. Okay, there's moments of happiness to all of us. In general, in life, look at the people. You see what's going on. Not to talk about the anger and the frustration and all kinds of other problems in life. The problem between someone that is deeply in the Torah to someone is not, it's the mental freedom, which means when your mind is so deep in the Torah, no matter what crisis you have in life and stress and problems and things that supposedly you're supposed to worry about, it releases you from all of that. You're very peaceful, it elevates your emuna, it gives you the right immune system spiritually against all these things. And other people that do not have the Torah, they need chemical. They need all kinds of things to be able to smile, unfortunately, in this stressful world. That's what it means, Ben Chorin. Ben Chorin, not that he became a millionaire because he became an Avrech Kolel, no. Or because he doesn't have a boss. Or because he doesn't have things that he has to run and kill himself to achieve. No. Everything, olam kemina go noeg. Mentally, it releases the person. Because if you take any other person in America that get the salary of Avrech Kolel, even here in Muncie, he would kill himself in 3 weeks. When you tell him you're making $500 a month and your rent is $1,500. Go tell it to Tony and Vinny. In America, let's see what they're gonna do. It's not even, they can't even digest what you just said. Are you serious? It's a joke. But to live and to learn with happiness, with devotion, like nothing is scaring me, nothing, and another month, and it's been going on for 20 years, and the family is only growing, and the stress supposedly is supposed to be higher and higher. You know, in Bnei Brak, it's the city with the lowest amounts of heart attacks in the whole world. From all the cities in the world, you know how many thousands of cities you have in the world? Bnei Brak, number one in less cases. I mean, bottom line, the last one on the list. No, almost nobody compared to the rest of the world gets heart attacks there. Now everybody knows what's the reasons for heart attacks. Number one reason, stress. That's number one killer. Now you may come and say, well, Bnei Brak, everyone is skinny and running in a treadmill for an hour a day, nobody smokes, everyone is healthy. The answer, you know, it's not the case. It's not fair to ask you after this delicious chulent. Now I want to tell you the words of the Zohar. Kol man dishtadel beoraita. Someone that puts efforts in a Torah, he has this world and Olam Haba, and the next world. Even a person that puts efforts in a Torah, ולא ישתדל בה לשמה, not for the sake of heaven, לא לשם שמיים. For different reasons he learns Torah. Maybe for shiduch. Many people go to good yeshivot only for the shiduch. If you offer them the shidduch that they want, something like that, before they go, right away they change their plans in life. I said, no, I got to be there 2-3 years to suffer until they offer me the right shidduch. What can I do? That's how my brothers got shidduch. When I say I'm in that yeshiva, I have a good chance. But what's the only reason he went there? To be a Talmid Chacham, to learn? No, just to get a good shidduch, establish a frum home, to make his parents happy, and that's it. Olam kiminago noeg. That's obviously not learning Leshem Shamayim. Oh, somebody wants to be a Rav, to make a salary, to make money, to charge money, to do all kinds of things. So it says like this, someone who learns Shelo Leshem Shamayim, the Zohar say, Zaki Leagra Tava Baal Maden, he gets reward in this world, Velo Dainin Le Be'ahu Alma. So he's not as great as someone who learned Leshem Shamayim, not as great, but it's still a huge achievement. First, you get a big reward here, whatever the reward is, with your children, with your marriage, with your money, whatever it be, with your health. It gives you a special blessing. But in the next world, the judgment that you were supposed to have if you were not learning Torah is nothing compared to what it's going to be now. It's much, much, much less. Even if the learning wasn't Leshem Shamayim. So even learning not Leshem Shamayim also has a huge level. People mezalzel. What is he learning for? He learning for Leshem Shamayim? First, let's see you learning not Leshem Shamayim, then you criticize someone who doesn't learn Leshem. Most people don't learn at all. Take all the 2 million Orthodox people in the world. Let's say half of them are men, million. How many of them sit and learn every day, don't miss a day? How many? 150,000? Maybe, I don't know. I don't know the numbers, I'm just guessing. But it's definitely not everyone. I have people with beautiful beards and nice sombreros that confess to me in many places that I speak that they didn't open a book for the whole last month. Not even a minute. But they consider ultra, ultra Orthodox. So it's a problem. This was the introduction to what we really wanted to say here tonight. Bear with me a few more minutes that we get the right advice. Kol ha-mashchir panav, someone that his face changed the color. That's an expression, metaphoric. Ba'olam hazeh, nobody blonde become black. Relax if you learn Torah. It's an expression that we learn so much that metaphorically, it changed the shape of your face. That's how much effort you put. HaKadosh Baruch Hu Mav'ik Zivo La'olam Haba. Hashem shines for him in the next world. Kol HaMariv Atzmo Al Divrei Torah Ba'olam Hazeh, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Masbi'o La'olam Haba. Someone that makes himself starving in this world for Torah, Hashem makes him very full in Olam Haba. This is Gemara in Sanhedrin Kuf. Kol haosek b'Torah nechasav matzlichim lo. Let's see if it's true or not in a minute. Aval lifamim, I want to ask you a question. There is a statement here in the Gemara, Avodah Zarah, page Yutet. Kol haosek b'Torah nechasav matzlichim lo. I can show you from the top of my head 1,000 people that oskim b'Torah that has had money and lost all of it. So what does it mean, nechasav matzlichim lo? What did the Gemara mean? When the Gemara say, kol haosek b'Torah, everyone who learns Torah, his business is blooming. Everyone that osek b'Torah, everywhere he puts his money, he becomes a prophet? Sometimes yes, sometimes not. Can't lie to ourselves, reality-wise. Yes, maybe it's more blessing, maybe, you know, makes the person sharper, even in business. I'm not saying no, of course. But is it a statement? Can we make it a rule in nature that by you being learning seriously for hours every day, all your businesses are blooming automatically? It means you're not going to have chas v'shalom bankruptcy, no problems, no partner who steal from you, no government issues, no penalties, no competition, no court cases. Let's be honest, it's not the case. So what is the Gemara meant? This is what it means. Sometimes Hashem knows that if he will let a person succeed materialistically in this world, it will make him go far away from the Torah automatically. There's two kinds of people. Some people, the more they succeed in business, the more they realize that Hashem does anything anyway. Why should I kill myself? Hashem does everything. I see whatever I thought I know, Hashem taught me that He does everything. So why should I kill myself? Let me trust Him. Let me focus more in Torah. He goes less and less to the office until he hardly shows his face there. Why? He decided that Hashem does everything. He'll do the learning. Some people the other way around. The more they succeed in business, the more they feel that I have to supervise now. I open another store. I open another factory. I have to hire another 10 people, another 20 people. Where do I have time to learn Torah? These kind of people, if they are oskim b'Torah, as a gift, Hashem doesn't want to make them millionaires. They hope that they have plenty of money one day. They don't have to worry about parnasa. But Hashem knows better. Once He gives them the money, everything will fall apart. Im ya'ashir, ifsha. He become a criminal, lo alenu. The Torah says, lifnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu, another mashal, metaphoric. The Torah came in front of Hashem and say, בשמאלה עושר וכבוד. On the left, wealth and honor. מפני מה בני עניים? Why there are people that learn Torah and they're poor? If there is a promise to be rich. The answer, הקדוש ברוך הוא משיבה להנחיל אוהבה יש. I want to give 310 spiritual worlds of reward to my lovers, those who follow me. What's better? I'll give them 310 words, or I'll replace it with a few million dollars that will take them away from the Torah, distract them, and in the end they'll get nothing. Not only not they won't get 310, they get nothing in the end. If they're lucky, they won't make it to the other side. So they are aniim ba'olam hazeh. They are aniim. They are poor in this world. But they are very, very rich to Olam Haba. If it's good for them to be also rich over here, no contradiction, why not? I'll give them wealth here as much, as well. But if not, what's the point? It's going to be against them. Shlosha kadosh baruch hu bocheh aleihem bechol yom. Three Hashem cries on them every day. One of them is one sheyachol la'asok b'torah ve'eno osek. Literally, Hashem is crying for him. How does a person become Shakdan, the real Masmid? How? The answer, Mordechai HaYehudi, Mordechai, we just finished Purim now. It says in the end of the Megillah, Mordechai Ratzui Lerov Echav, to most of his brothers in Sanhedrin. The head of the Sanhedrin is the biggest Chacham, used to teach there. Not everyone is pleased with him. Why? Because he went to politics. We are a few days before the election. Few of the rabbis went to the Knesset. It's a fact. They used to be big Talmidei Chachamim, learning all their life. One day they saw that they're very sharp. They offered them a Volvo. They like the curtains on the back. They said, no problem, we're going to the Knesset. So now they became askanim. They became politicians. How much they learned Torah? Nothing compared to what it used to be, obviously. They have to sit there with few of the Arabs and the other clowns and to listen to their nonsense all day. The question is, do they deserve to get punished for that, or they're actually serving us? Somebody has to do that dirty job. Yes, you get paid well for that, fine. But it's a dirty job. Everyone agree. It's a dirty job. They came to my cousin when Shas got 17 chairs in a Knesset. Remember 20 years ago, 16 years ago? He was very sharp in Or HaChaim Yeshiva in Yerushalayim. They came to Rav Elbaz, said, give us somebody very sharp here. He said, him. They came to him and said, Zgan Sar. First now, you're going to start as right-hand man of the minister. Later, you'll be a minister yourself. Taking him from the yeshiva directly into the Knesset. Not some people have to be first, the mayor, and run for this committee and that. After 20 years in politics, you make it into the Knesset. Him from the stander directly to be almost a tsar. Big jump. He answered them, that's the biggest insult someone ever insulted me. I couldn't believe. We're offering you such a thing you don't want. I want to learn Torah. But some people went to do it. Now the question is, the people that went to do it, they deserve a reward or they deserve a punishment for that? They're fighting for Torah. They want more shuls to open up. They want budgets for religion. They want to take care of the funeral homes and the cemeteries and the mikveh. So many things that we need. You pay so much taxes, you want some of these taxes to go back to religious causes instead of to the sport and to the theaters. Some of it you want to go back to the community. Somebody has to go sit there and fight a dirty war to get some of what we deserve without the war. We deserve it without the war. But you're not going to get a penny unless you're going to have someone to scream and fight there. We know the rules. The question is, what should we do? Should we not be in politics? Nobody should be in politics. Let the secular people eat the cake, take everything for themselves, starve us to death, close all the yeshivot or half of the yeshivot. Is this the alternative? Depend who you ask. Some people tell you better that. Some people tell you, no, sit inside and fight. I'm not here to come to decide which side is right. But one thing I want to ask. Mordechai was a perfect tzaddik. Thanks to him, the entire nation of Israel got saved. Why the people of the Sanhedrin, not everyone bowed down to him and kissed his hand? I don't get it. Before he saved the Jewish nation, you can say, hey, Mordechai, why don't you trust Hashem, sit with us and learn and cry to Hashem to cancel Haman's decree? No, I understand where it comes from. But after his plan succeeded, and everybody saw that him, Mordechai, and Esther saved the Jewish nation, now, after all that, they should have taken their head off and say, Mordechai, Chazak u'Baruch, thanks to you, we're going to stay alive and not one Jew would die. But this was actually written after the miracle. Mordechai ratzui lerov echav. What does it mean? Not God forbid that they had something in their heart against him because bitul Torah. No. Pikuach nefesh matzdik bitul Torah. Ma? If you're a tzala driver and someone is, you got a heart attack and you're in the middle of learning, you got a call, you must close the Gemara. Say, so, let me finish the sugiyah, then I go. You immediately become a murderer. I have to finish this Tosfot. He said there 5 more minutes, this person died. So, well, Limud Torah keneged kulam. Everyone know you're a total fool. Well, how are you going to justify it? Even though it's a punishment to close the book, that's for sure. You sit by the lake and someone is drowning and you have to close the Gemara and run, save him, and he's sweating and you save his life. In the end, it wasn't a reward, it was a punishment. You had to lose an hour of learning. But is still an obligation. So the answer here, everyone was attached to Mordechai as a teacher. Once he went to politics, his mind wasn't in a learning like before. He couldn't give them the level of this of the shiurim that he was given. So many of them went out of his class. Okay, let me go to a different melamed. Your head is in the politics. This is the way it is. Once your mind is occupied in something else besides the Torah, it comes always on the expense of the Torah. There's not one time that a person left the Torah partially and started to deal with business or politics or all kinds of other things, and it didn't come on the expense of the Torah. You should know that. And I'm going to read it to you word by word. The Gemara in Sanhedrin, Megillah, Tetzayin, Rashi writes, לפי שבטל מדברי תורה ונכנס לסררה, מרדכי stopped to learn as much as he was learning and went into politics, into control. סררה, אף על פי ששם המשיכו חזל, חזל continue over there, גדול תלמוד תורה יותר מהצלת נפשות. Learning Torah is bigger than what מרדכי did, which means the person... according to the halakha, a person has to close his learning and to go and to try to save by the king the rest of the Klal Israel. Right? Still, the learning of the Torah is higher. Someone that zoche la'asok ba'Torah ve'lo ba'al lidei atzalat nefashot is greater than someone who actually runs and saves life. That's why the Chazon Ish wrote, he says that the people that do kiruv, Everybody knows to save souls is the biggest mitzvah. כל המציל נפש אחת וכו'. אבל לחזוני יש חידוש. He says someone who learns in yeshivot is just as big and bigger. Because without זכות התורה, not one Jew would become בעל תשובה. Because it's one unit. One, an army, if the soldier wants to break into a bunker, they won't be able to do it on their own. They need the airplanes to come and drop a few bombs and make the enemy confused, and then they can break in. Without the planes, they wouldn't do it. In the end, they get the credit, the soldiers, because they went and captured the terrorists, whatever. But somebody was pulling the stripes behind. And this is the Air Force. Same thing here. People that learn Torah give zchut to the world, to all kinds of things to come to Klal Yisrael. One of it is that more lost souls will have the zchut to hear, to participate, and to do tshuva. And Chazon Ish says, Gadol Talmud Torah yoter ma'atzalat nefashot in this aspect. So it says like this. The father of the Gra, the Gaon Mivilna, asked him and prevented him from learning pharmacology. He wanted to learn about medicine, to do part-time, to be a pharmacist. And his father did not agree. He didn't let him do it. And that's without college like today, that everyone is naked over there and they teach horrible things over there against Hashem. Without that, to learn it on his own in his free time, to get some books of refuah, and to learn how to mix medicine, handmade, and to make parnasa. The Vilna Gaon. His father refused. Why? Because he saw that the patients that will start coming to him for medicine will take him away from his Torah, and he saw his talent. You know, this is Atzat HaYetzer HaRa. He's going to start being a pharmacist. Half of his day will go to pharmacy. But pharmacy saves life. You give patients medicine to save their life. What's wrong with that? But his father knew Talmud Torah is much, much greater than save lives. Now, we have a contradiction in the words of Chazal that we have to understand. Chazal say, it says like this. Chazal asking a question in Megillat et Zayin. It says, Mordechai was mentioned the fourth one in the list of the Chachamim that went to Eretz Israel in their generation. And in another verse, is mentioned the fifth. Why? What happened? Somebody got in front of him in a list. The answer, that's before he went into politics, and that's after he went to politics. But the politics was kosher to save life. The answer is, but he took him down on his level in Torah. Why? His mind was somewhere else. So one rule, to be able to succeed in your Torah, you have to make sure your mind is clear as much as possible from any other thing. Definitely from sport and from baseball games. My father is taking us to the Yankee Stadium tomorrow. Do you want to say, you agree your son comes with us? Then you ask yourself, well, I don't get it. What's going on? Sit there with 70,000, all kinds of horrible people, to sit together with them, to see how they care, how they talk, how they behave over there, and to let take yeshiva bachurim to see these things, and then to say, yeah, don't be fanatic. It's good for the Yetzer Hara. Yeah, we find excuses for everything. It starts like that, and it ends who knows where. There is a pasuk. I want you to explain this pasuk to me. Noef isha chasar lev. Mishlei, Proverbs 6, verse 32. That's the source. Noef isha chasar lev. What's the meaning of the verse? Noef, everybody knows what it is. Isha, we know what it is. Chasar lev, that means he doesn't have a heart. Meaning, it's a very bad thing to do. Is he talking about Noef, Lot in Af, from the Ten Commandments? What King Solomon is talking about? You'll be surprised. The answer, the Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin, page Tzadik Tet, the Gemara say, Ze halomet Torah liprakim. What's the connection between the Pasuk to the meaning? you tell me if there's one word connected here. Noef isha chasar lev literally means someone who takes a married woman and makes an avera with her. It's a person that has no heart. No heart. It's cruel to do such thing. Okay, we got it. Even the goyim agree on that. It's a well-known thing in the world. But the Gemara doesn't even talk about this subject. The Gemara says, you know, you want to know what this verse is, means? It means someone that learned the Torah portions. A little bit now, a little bit later, a little bit. He has a lot too many breaks, like putting the water on the fire, taking it off, putting it on, taking it off, putting it on. You never boiled it once in your life. The answer is, the Primegadim answer, this Kashia, he says, someone that does the sin with a married woman, what's on his mind while he's doing the Avera? Let me run out of here quick before I get caught. So he's in a rush. He's nervous all the time to get caught. So because he's disturbed by not getting caught, he's not focusing on the Avera so much. The Primegadim say, he didn't come there to have children. He came there to make an Avera. Same thing, someone that learns and doesn't give his heart to understand everything in a sugya. Why? He's in a rush to finish the Torah. I don't have time to stuck here. I gotta run. If I'm gonna stuck in the sugya another day and another day, where will I ever finish? Let me know, 70% is also good. Someone that learns like that, after 50 years, you ask him to give one drasha on one topic on in the shas, he doesn't know. And you'll find people like this that they don't know. And I can tell you that all over the years that Bachurei Yeshiva comes to the Shabbos table and they learn, some of them for years, and you tell them to say Dvar Torah, some of them cannot say more than 5 seconds Dvar Torah. You ask yourself, how can it be? Ma, you're in Yeshiva from morning to night, 6, 7, 10, 15 years. You cannot say one normal Dvar Torah. Something is not right here, my friend. You cannot take as a sugya and explain it, 5, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, who's against who, what's the pshat here, what's the contradiction over there, to say one Dvar Torah. What's the reasons for that? Let's see what's going on here. Why we are not achieving a lot the way we're supposed to. Besides the efforts, that we're not willing to give so much efforts, there is another reason for that. It's called Yehush. We've been mityayesh. We learn, then we don't remember anything. Then we learn another sugya, we don't remember. We learn another one, we don't remember. After 10 times you learn and try, and you don't remember, you lose the geschmack in the learning. Say, let me just learn because I'm afraid Hashem punish me, it's an obligation. I know it keeps me on track, but nothing would come out of me. I already know. So one rule is, atzat ha-yetzer hara, that almost nobody repeats his learning. To repeat the learning, it's not a recommendation, it's an obligation. Minimum 4 times to repeat every page you learn. Minimum, less than that is nothing to talk about. I am in a rush. My friend, he came with me in the same week to the yeshiva, is already 30 pages ahead of me. Who cares? No nafkamina at all. No nafkamina. Your reward can be a lot greater than him in Shammai. Just to do siyumim, siyum, 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 siyum. Who do you care about the show of siyum, siyum, to eat some cookie and make lechaim? The question is, if one of these siyumim count in Shammayim, that's the question. If it's count in Shammayim, I take my hat off. Fine. But, siyum. Ask him 5, 10 questions on a masechet. See if he knows what's going on. That's atzat ha-yetzer hara. That's how the Satan make people fall in his trap. You're going to be 20 years and in the end you won't have control, shlita in one sugiya. Also, halacha. Many people learn halachot, but in kitzurim, they don't really learn the whole sugya. That's why it's easy to forget. Because how many provisions in a book you can remember? 1, 2, 10, 20, 50, 100. Eventually, after a year, you begin to forget. But if you put your heart into the whole sugya, It's difficult to forget. There are a few more advices to improve the memory that I'm going to give you, and we'll finish with that. One is to learn from the book directly and not by heart, to actually look at the words and the letters. Second, not to jump from one subject to another, to focus on one subject while you're learning, to put all your efforts in one subject. Third, better to learn from Chtav Ashuri than regular Hebrew. Another advice, to learn by singing. There is something in the brain, when you sing the learning, it's absorbed very strong in the memory. Nigun. Very good advice. Everything you learn, find someone to teach it to. Because by teaching, you find all the things that you don't understand. And then later you go and fix it. I can tell you from experience. Sometimes you mark a few things that you want to speak about. While you're giving the lecture, you're looking at certain things, hey, I didn't see it before. It's not what I thought. And then you are forced in the middle of the lecture, and it happened to me a few times already here tonight. You have to skip it. Why? You don't want to take a risk in front of the camera, gamble, and then later come and see you say the opposite. Better not to say than to say something questionable. Why is it? Because you don't prepare it correctly. If you prepare it four times and you go and you teach it to someone and all that, then you come, you're mamash in full control. That's why the melamdim, they know the best. I had a rav from Tzfat. Tzfat is teaching high school in Eretz Israel. So I was asking my son questions in a Gemara, in a mafkid. Basically, he knows the whole perek of the mafkid word by heart. You can see right away. Anything he was talking, he knew the whole thing. He was starting to say the whole Gemara by heart. Why? How many years, 30 years in his life, he constantly repeated it hundreds of times. He knows it by heart. Teaching to others is a very wonderful way to remember what you learn. Second, another way, never to be in a rush. Never. Rush is not allowed in learning. Rush maybe in a business. Rush maybe in cutting your grass. But when you learn this term, I'm in a rush, I have to be maspik, I'm behind, doesn't exist. If you start with this, I have to achieve this by this date and by this and by this, you achieve nothing in the end. Of course, you don't want to waste time, and you don't want to coffee, cigarettes, in and out, telephone. Of course not. We're talking someone who's serious in the learning. No chipazon. The chipazon is min ha-satan. Another advice, try to do everything you can to learn Torah l'shem shamayim. Not for kavod, not for ego, not to show you better than others, not for the good shiduch. All of that will come anyway. But the main thing, Hashem, you know why I learn here? I know you want it. If you like it, if you're happy, I'm happy. That's it. That's why, even if the topic, this particular topic, doesn't attract you so much, you rather learn something else, but this is what they learn right now in a Seder. Doesn't matter, because I'm here to make you happy. One way or the other, eventually I would love it. Mitoch shelo lishma ba lishma. Be always on time. Hashem, check carefully if you makpid to come on time to the Sedarim or not, or to your Chevruta, Koveh Itim. Pray every day with tears to Hashem, help me in my learning. Everybody knows the famous story with the Sde Chemed, Rav Chisliya Medini, that somebody in Yeshiva hated him and he bribed the cleaning lady, the Arab cleaning lady, to tell a lie that he was messing around with her. And it was all a lie. And his Rosh Yeshiva said, I know you innocent, I know it. But between you and me, because of all the Chilul Hashem and Lashon Hara, maybe move to another town, wait there for a few months, and then I'll tell you when to come back. He went to an isolated place. One day this Arab wanted to do tshuva. She came to look for him. She asked around. She came to his place. She begged him to come. I confess. I'll say that he bribed me. He was already getting dressed to come back with her. And then he realized, he said, listen, I'll go back. she's going to point to this guy that bribed her, and it's going to be another 2-3 months of Chilul Hashem in town, such a shame for religion, for the religious community. It's going to go all over that people do such horrible things. Better I'll suffer the rest of my life and will not cause this Chilul Hashem. So he said to her, you know what, I changed my mind. I don't go with you. I'll stay here, you don't worry. You go back to the yeshiva, nobody has to know, you get your job back. Because she asked him, when I confess, just please talk to the Rosh Yeshiva to keep me at my job. So he told her, you can have your job, don't tell anyone anything, I'm staying here, you're good, I forgive you. And he writes that after that moment, his brain opened up. Up to then, he didn't have so much atzlacha in his learning. But that day, it's like Hashem replaced his brain with a much sharper brain. Everything he was learning, 1, 2, 3, he gets the point. So we see that in the learning, there's also a lot of candies that Hashem gives. It's not only how much you put and how much you learn and how many hours and how sharp you are. All of that is important. But there's also gifts from Hashem. And gifts from Hashem is critical when you're not so talented. Not everyone is the Gaon Mivilna. Not everyone has such a brain. So if Hashem sees that you're so much into it and you learn and you give your heart, he gives you gifts. And all of a sudden, you have, slowly, you're not even realizing, you begin to understand and to remember and to succeed and more things opening up and you begin to see the light of the Torah. And from then on, the road to success is expressed. So it's a gift. It's 100% if a person, based on how much you put effort. One more thing, never to get angry. The more angry you get, the worse you're going to do on your learning. Kol ha-koes chokhmato mistaleket mimeno. It's a fact. If you have 100 million words of Torah by the age of 60, you just got furious and scream and bang on the table, it went down to 99 million. You get angry at tomorrow morning, it could be to 95 million. 10, 20 times you get confused. You don't know what's going on with me. Lo lachnis rosho ledvarim betelim. Not, you don't care what Obama said, you don't care what the other one said, you don't care what just happened with ISIS in the Middle East, it's nothing to do with me. The leader should break their head about the situation. I'm here. My whole world is the Torah. I know people in my kollel, in Yerushalayim, they don't know who the prime minister is. Literally, they don't know Netanyahu is the prime minister. No exaggeration, I promise you. They don't know the minister of defense. They don't know who is the religious Havre Knesset. Nothing. Most of them don't have phones, and some of them have phones from the day of Antiochus. You know, they did 15 minutes until the light goes on. You see how they don't even know how to use the phone. Like only for real emergency. Sometimes the whole day the phone is off. You know, I found a way to give messages to the kollel through someone who lives nearby by sending him WhatsApp messages. Why? I don't even try to get the rabbi that runs the show. Why? I know his phone is 99% of the time off. Why? When they learn, they don't care about the world. Nothing. No business, no opportunity here, and opportunity over there. Lo lachnis rosho bedvarim betelim. Game, championship. Talmid Yeshiva talks about this nonsense. If they only knew how much damage it makes to their learning, I promise you they'll never dare to turn the computer one time on this nonsense. Now, I know that sometimes a person needs to listen to music. It's a spiritual thing. It can relax a person. But the truth is that someone whose mind is deep in the Torah never has the need to listen to music. Never, never. Why? It's music for him, it's like replacing diamonds with gold. Why should I do that? I have diamonds, what do I need? People who don't have diamonds, of course they want gold. Music relaxes them. Someone that is deep in the Talmud, in the Gemara, in the Rambam, in Kabbalah, whatever he learns, he needs music to relax him. What's going on here? It doesn't make sense. To make sure to be always tahor. Tilat yadayim, mikveh, these things help the learning. Not to leave open books and leave. It's no joke. Either put something to cover it or close it. Accept the suffering with love. It helps the learning a lot. Not to eat too much. To eat very little in every one of the meal. Never to be full up to here. Even in a fancy wedding that you gave a nice gift, you don't have to take advantage on a whole check. It's no problem. One guy came to the wedding. Food was so delicious. He's eating what he doesn't eat in a kollel all week. He ate in 1 hour. Then his friend, he said to him, wow, the dessert is coming. I have to vomit. His friend told him, listen, go to the bathroom, stick your finger in your throat, vomit that you can eat the dessert. So he told him, you're crazy. If I could stick a finger in my throat, I would eat this pickle the size of my finger. I can't even put it. The food is already up to here. The more you eat, especially delicious this and delicious that, it's definitely not pat bamelach. One more sgula to be successful in your learning, to give kavod to talmidei chachamim. Definitely never to speak lashon hara against them, even if you disagree with his political views, even if you disagree with some of his teaching. Who are you to criticize him? Say, I don't understand, or my rabbi say something different than this chacham. But I give him full respect. This is one of the sicknesses of our generation. Talmidei chachamim became shoes in the eyes of the public. There's no more respect like it used to be. In the old days, when a chacham came to the room, people could not move. I was shaking. My cousin told me when Chacham ben Zion Abba Shaul entered the shiur, you could cut the air with the knife. That's how everyone was focused just from there. And after years that they are in the shiur, years, every day. Why? The people understood what it means. In some communities, they still give a lot of respect to Chachamim. Do you see that even the secular people among them respect the Chachamim a lot? Even they're far away from Torah, Chaz v'Shalom, Hashem Yirachem, some of them are already merry goyim. But if a Chacham come to their place, like the king came. Look at the Syrian community, that's one example. Chacham, 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 Chacham. The world doesn't exist now. Don't pass phones. Don't send me no line one, no line two. The Chacham is sitting here. The world doesn't exist. Not here, take the check, I'm busy, Rabbi. No such thing. Kavod l'chachamim, which is something that the internet helped to destroy in our generation. It's hard to believe, it's hard to believe people that have a yarmulke on their head, the things they write in the internet on Gdolei Ador. And hard to believe. You wonder to yourself how this person is not shaking for what they're going to do to him in Gehenom for these words. If he only knew these 5 sentences that he wrote, how many thousands of years he's going to cry for it, he will kill himself. What did he gain by writing that? Nothing, only make more sinah. Ay, 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 ay. Try to learn from one source than to run from one source to another and get confused. Who is your rabbi? You agree with his shita? It makes sense to you. You understand what he wants. You understand the way he teach. You feel that brings you happiness. Stick to this chacham. Don't run from one to another. A little bit from here, a little bit from there, because there's different shitot, different hanagot. Never to rate the Torah that some of it is more important than others. All Torah, every word in the Torah, even the word Esav. You hear the word Esav, you hear the word Yosef or Abraham, it's words from the Torah. All words from the Torah is equal. That's why the Sfaradim don't stand when they read the Ten Commandments. On purpose. They say, if you stand here, that means it's more important than the other Torah. Cannot do it. Different minagim, everyone has his own logic. On the other hand, the reason that you can stand is because, after all, it was given on a board, when other parts of the Torah wasn't given on a board, so you stand for the Ten Commandments. Some is one of these arguments that both sides are right. You need Mashiach to tell you which one is more right. Until he comes, we don't know. One more thing is not to sleep inside the yeshiva. Not to put the head and sleep. You want to sleep, go outside and sleep. Don't sleep inside the yeshiva, because as is Torato na'aset kraim kraim. Other thing, don't deal with public work. Don't volunteer to do this, to run the gmach, to do this. It's big mitzvot, but it will come on the expense of your Torah, guarantee. The question is, what's more important for you? You want to be askan ish tzibur, that's what you chose, fine. You want to be a learner, learning is everything. You want to do both, it's a problem. Not to wear two clothes together. Two shirts together, or take two shirts together, kashe l'shichicha. Not to dry your hands with your clothes. Now it's a mystical thing. When you say Ahava Rabba, or Sfaradim say Ahavat Olam, say it with broken hearts. If with tears, it's even better. Ahavat Olam, Ahavtanu, Torah u'mitzvot, Chukim u'mishpatim, all these parts that to aim on a Torah, also Birkot HaTorah in the morning. Some people think that if they eat from the edge of the bread, they take the end of the bread, it will cause them to forget. So they skip the first part and they eat from the middle. So they cut it, they remove it. But that's a problem. Because you don't want to, after you make the bracha amotzi, don't waste time. Cut and then cut another piece. The source that it caused shichecha just doesn't exist. Nowhere. Somebody made it up. So, therefore, you cut the bread and you eat right away the first piece. En divrei Torah mitkayimim ela b'mi shememit atzmo aleha. You give everything you have in this. It becomes your full profession. אמר להם משה, we'll finish with this, אמר להם משה לישראל, שמה אין אתם יודעים כמה צער נצטערתי על התורה. If you only knew how much sorrow and pain I had for the Torah. כמה עמל עמלתי בה, how much efforts I put into it. כמה יגיעה יגעתי בה, נפשי נתתי עליה. I gave my heart for the Torah. דמי נתתי עליה. I put my blood for the Torah. And I taught you the Torah with tzar, with so much pain and effort. That's how you should do the same when you teach. לא תמצא תורה שבעל פה, meaning Mishnah and Gemara, אצל מי שמבקש עונג העולם, תאווה וכבוד וגדולה בעולם הזה. You want this world, you'll never be nothing in the Torah. אלא במי שממית עצמו עליה. You cannot learn Torah שבעל פה unless if it's with צער, with efforts, with agony, with pain. יעזק המוות. It's hard like death. That's how hard it is to gain control on this Torah. לפי שיש בה צער גדול ונדודי שינה. זה מדרש תנחומה. The Meir says on this, Chochma u'musar evelim evilim bazu. It's pasuk in Mishle Aleph, Proverbs 1, verse 7. Ilu tomar lasachal shebaschalim, to the dumbest of all dumb people. Atirtze shetiye chacham keshlomo. You want me to make you smart like Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon? En safek sheyomar ken. Of course you would say. The dumbest person in the world, you go like this and become Shlomo HaMelech. When the fool came to Shammai, Azaken, Shammai, Hillel and Shammai, he came to Shammai. He said to him, Lamdeni et kol ha-Torah beregel echad. When I'm standing on one feet, teach me the whole Torah. אבל כשיאמרו לו שהחוכמה אינה מלבוש, שתמצאנו מתוקן לגופך, what do you think? It's a suit? You put it on and now you're dressed? You have to get up early, you have to stay late, you have to kill yourself on it, you have to give up so many things you desire. So basically, we always come down to the same thing. The main thing is amal. Without it, there's nothing to talk about. We have to admit, we're very spoiled. We care about our car, we care about the air condition, we care about the food, we care about the clothes, we care about the vacation, we care about the homes, we care about so many things that someone who wants to be chacham should not bother him a minute in his life. A minute in his life. When we were davening here in Shul a few months ago, one Ashkenazi Israeli builder, contractor, was a guest for Shabbat. So he came to me and my friend, and he said to us, I went to Rav Chaim Kanievsky, and I saw this mold on the wall, mold, green mold. I came to his grandson, I said, me and my son has a construction business. I want to come and fix it quietly, don't worry, it won't make mess here. Little by little, free of charge, we want to fix it. It's dangerous for the health. So the grandson said, you want to get me into trouble with my grandpa? Please, it's enough. He doesn't want to fix anything here already. For years, everyone offer. He doesn't want to make changes. So he said to him, no, I'm not talking cosmetic. It's not good for the health. He is here already so many years. He doesn't care about this thing. No matter what he did, refused to accept the fixing job. One person went to Rav Steinman. He saw his kitchen from 70 years ago, 60 years ago. I don't think there's one more kitchen like this left in the world from 70 years ago, with this little Israeli wood rose. You know? Even when I was a kid, it was out of style. He begged him to renovate the whole house, the whole apartment, to make it nice, clean. Refused to accept. Refused to accept. The level of the people that became who they became, they didn't become who they became because they were 3 hours a day on the internet, watching songs on YouTube. And again, I'm not talking Averos. Averos is nothing to talk about. That's destroyed the whole Torah. I'm talking kosher things only. Haredi singer and beautiful entertainer, everything, all glad kosher. You want to be Talmid Chacham, one thing leads to another. That leads to that, and that leads to the Yankees, and that leads to the circus, and then these twin brothers who juggle. And the next thing, you come after 40 years and say, no, what? 40 years you're in Kollel, what can you say? Basically nothing. And remember, this is mamash the curse of life, that a person is one leg in a Torah and one leg on a beach. And that's in the end, nothing comes out of him, nothing. We see, I'm telling you, I see it everywhere I go. Not to talk about the fact that you can have a person that is in yeshiva learning 20 years, and in the end he comes and he tells you that he worships someone that died. That's his real God. That's even not to talk about this. You ask yourself, where is the head of this person? Where was he 20 years learning? He's supposed to be smart. How do you say that someone that you just saw, they putting his body in the ground, he never died? It's a lie. The grave, the box was empty. It's nothing. He's here. You don't see him. I see him. You don't see him. Things that people talk. You ask yourself, how did it happen to this person that he sits in a place and learned Torah that he became so foolish? You wonder, how does it happen? The answer is, because I told you why. We mentioned only, believe me, there's so many more things I didn't read. There's no time, we have to finish now. But if we want to gain Torah, remember what I said. Kviat itim is bedieved. Real obligation is every minute. Every minute. Even when you go away with your children in Chol HaMoed and they run and whatever they do, you still have the obligation. Not to burn time, not to burn the life. When we will wake up, when we get old, we may be too late. Bezrat Hashem, yi ratzon that this shiur will be for all of us, first for myself and then to you. We'll all be have the zchut to be mekayem some of what we say. That's already a big achievement. Baruch Adonai le'olam. Amen ve'amen.